going forward. Let's get across what's driving oil prices from here. We'll bring in Peter Maguire, CEO of XM.com. He's joining us live from our Sydney City studio. Great to see you there, Peter. Thanks very much for joining us.
Good afternoon, Leanne.
Now, let's get your thoughts on those oil prices and how they traded today. Lower, in fact. Investors have been taking those profits after rising in the previous session. It really seems like increasing oil drilling activity in the United States is still a concern.
Well, it certainly is. And when you take on board, you know, the volatility that we've seen, Leanne, since the start of the month. We're up 10%, then down a few percent. We're only at the 13th of September. So it's had very, very large whipsaw action over the last, you know, 2 weeks. And you've had those drillers coming in from the States. You've had the hedge funds participating. And the whole market is certainly creating a lot of, great trading opportunities, but more importantly, wild swings.
I noticed the OPEC group's come out with some more forecasts for 2017, and they're pretty much the same, but they've switched the growth that's coming from OPEC and pushed it a little bit more to the non-OPEC. Is that going to be part of the emerging trend, and that with an eye, of course, to Algiers coming out later this month?
Well, exactly, Tony. Look, we're 2 weeks away from Algiers as far as that agency meeting. There'll be a lot of talk there. We're worried certainly about where Iran's situated as far as its production numbers. It wants to increase and get up back over 4 million barrels. Also, you've got the gorilla in the room as far as Saudi Arabia and, of course, what's happening with Russia. But taken all on board, The big giant field that we've kept an eye on for over a decade now that hasn't produced anything, Kashagan, that giant in Kazakhstan, is going to start production. And that's going to be very interesting how that plays, of course, into 17 and 18, Tony. So I think there's going to be a lot of points of conjecture, and that leads into the 30th of November, Tony, that meeting in Vienna for OPEC as well.
Is there any hope of the meeting producing something concrete this time around? We obviously know that things all failed back in April with Doha and so forth. Any hopes that we'll see something this time around?
Well, I think, first off, Leanne, I think that they want to work together. But the unsettling factor has certainly been those larger than expected numbers coming out of non-OPEC producers, and you've got everyone trying to maximise and get as much production as they can to shore up their own balance sheets. So there's a lot of, discontent amongst OPEC and non-OPEC members. I don't think necessarily you're going to see a lot of faith in this upcoming meeting. I think they'll push it out to the 30th of November, but the wild card is going to be Kashagan and what happens in 17 and 18.
Pete, where do you see the range on the oil price for, say, after the rest of the balance of this year? Because Brainard spoke about the fact that inflation was a big deal, and oil price being where it was, she felt that it was stabilising, so there was some comfort around what they could try and do with inflation. But what is the market expectations for the trend on oil as a range? Let's not give me the absolute price, but you know, you and I have spoken about this for a while, and, yeah, and to let you know, there's now 508 rigs in the US in the Baker Hughes. So she also mentioned that rigs were coming on the US on a more regular basis. So where's the range in your mind?
Well, they're steadily climbing, as you mentioned, Mark, and yeah, we've seen that from 1,400 down to 300 and now back over 500, which is a good sign. As far as, I think, of price, it'll have to be, you know, that 43, 44, and I'd say you may take 50 out. That sort of range, I think it's going to be range-bound until you see something dramatic. And that's got to be a weather outage, it's got to be a geopolitical concern, or it's got to have a production... Something's got to happen to really throw a spanner in the works, so to say, to see prices higher. As far as prices going much lower, there's got to be more rigs coming online in the States, and I don't necessarily think that's going to be the factor in the short to medium term.
Now, Tony mentioned there the revision of those oil supplies, those forecasts from OPEC, which is very, very interesting. They actually made no change to their demand outlook, did they? So not really market trying to rebalance, you know, is hoping for. In fact, at the start of 2016, I know OPEC was expecting the rebalancing to happen this year.
Yeah, well, that's exactly right, Leanne. And I think what's going to happen leading into 17 and 18, that's going to actually widen as far as excess capacity on a daily basis. So it's going to be very difficult for OPEC and non-OPEC producers to try and range-bound trade and of course, have some sort of equilibrium between consumption and production. So whilst you've got higher production coming in, and that's why I say Kashagan, for all the viewers out there, that you need to do a Google on that one. It's quite dramatic. It's the it's just a giant field in Kazakhstan. We've been waiting for a decade for it to come online, and the production numbers are going to be, you know, astronomical. So once it starts production and it really starts to, you know, turn the wheels, I think that that's going to be the outlier that's going to cause a great amount of concern to OPEC and non-OPEC members.
Peter, is there any, you know, in terms of the consumption, is the consumption story all around China? So we had some China data coming out saying, OK, there's a transition into a consumer society. Is that the hope that you've got, that it's China and maybe to a lesser extent India, but mainly it's more China?
Well, yes, it is, Mark, but also you've got to take on board. Have a look at those growth numbers. Like, we live in Sydney and they were saying, like, our population is going to increase 2 million over the next 20 years. Well, that's a global phenomenon because we're going from 7.2 to around about 9 billion people by 2040. So electricity consumption, all forms of energy, solar power and so on. So I think that whilst you look at China, there's plenty of other markets out there. Look at Africa, look at, you know, the Indias, of course, and Southeast Asia, South America. Those consumption patterns are going to increase, but I think that you're just going to see more production coming online because it's going to be cheaper. I think it's going to be a long time for you to see $80 to $100 a barrel. I don't think that's going to happen for at least, you know, 3 to 5 years. It may not never happen again.
But it's also, as well, people have been focused on oil, but there's those close alternatives, LNG and other gases and the like, that also provide the process for cars and et cetera.
And Elon Musk.
Yeah, that's right. The electricity, electric car, still a hydrogen car is still going. Are those factored into the forecast going forward, particularly in the context of global growth really not expected to go anywhere over the next little while?
Well, exactly right. Low inflation, Tony, and all of that. You know, you take that weak consumerism and weak demand picture as far as Europe. You know, we'll probably hit 100 million barrels going forward in the next, you know, decade or so. So the growth numbers are going to be there. You need something to dramatically change our addiction to crude oil. And I don't know whether it's going to happen. It may happen in my lifetime. You may see electric cars being the norm come 2025, driverless vehicles and so on. So it just depends as far as technology and how that whether it has the capacity to totally disrupt the incumbent players. We're very conscious as far as big oil and what its agenda is to keep on board and make sure that they don't lose market share. And that comes back to the next part, oil and oil exploration and gas. So it's a difficult time for many of those producers, both sovereign wealth and, of course, the large Chevrons and BPs. Mm.
Pete, just back on that data that we saw from China today, industrial output beating expectations, retail sales also beating expectations, fixed asset investment growth, that was relatively unchanged, just over 8% there. How did we see oil markets responding?
Well, I was quite surprised at it, Leanne. You know, we're waiting for it to drop, you know, this afternoon, and better than July's numbers. And so when you look at July, you probably think it was a little bit of a blip. We think that maybe moving forward, our economists are saying that you're probably going to see, you know, better than expected numbers coming in for the September and October period for China. So all that rallies forward. We also understand that leading into that, you know, the demand picture, it's starting to get a bit cooler in China going into October, November, heating oils and so on. So, you know, the consumption there we don't think is going to drop away. It'll probably stay at these sort of numbers, and we've got a lot of people, you know, buying cars on a daily basis, Leanne. So, you know, those roads in China are packed with cars. That's for one thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, on top of all of this, I mean, we talk about all of these factors, I guess, impacting oil markets at the moment, but these hedge funds, they seem to be tempering their bullishness towards the entire oil complex. And I suppose the question is whether the latest bout, we're seeing a lot of short selling, aren't we, in the market, whether this is the start of a new cycle or the continuation of the existing number four cycle.
Well, that's exactly right. You know, we've had four cycles since the start of 15, and the hedge funds have been all over it. They've been able to do some wonderful trading and, you know, and capture huge price moves. So in turn, they're saying, is this the start of the fifth or at the end of the fourth? And time will tell. We should know that within the next, you know, month and a half or 2 months to evaluate and look back, Leanne. and they're mounting in and they're building up their positions, pulling out of those longer positions of futures and options, and now they're, you know, recalibrating or re-engineering their own hedge book. So in turn, they see opportunities, and of course, they can drive markets and move markets, and we've seen that demonstrated time and time again in the last 2 years. So I don't think that their appetite is waning at all, and they are looking at, you know, where they can best get value. And taking that on board, they're keeping a close eye, Leanne, of course, with what happens in Algeria come the middle of, well, 2 weeks' time.
Absolutely.
Peter, how big a position do these people need to take to shift the dial on this sort of stuff? And does it become very crowded out? Like, when I think of hedge funds, often it will be, you know, I remember when I was working in the yen market, it was 3 to 5 big hedge funds, and that was it. You had to try and win their business. No one else had the expertise, if you like, in the asset class.
Yeah.
Tell me about oil. Is it more, is it 3 to 5 big hedge funds that drive the market, or is it more that it's quite a thin market when it needs to get moving?
Well, Mark, more importantly, I mean, there's a lot of big players out there, and they look at it. So you've got the big hedge funds, and they just see it's a, pardon the pun, a hugely liquid market. It's got very large price swings, so it appeals to them. And it seems to be, in some ways, those momentum trades build, and they're able to look at the seasonality of, naturally, the market, take on board weather expectations, weather water temperatures, and whether you're going to see hurricanes blowing into that Gulf region, what happens as far as the demand picture, of course the US dollar, and couple that with consumption. So it's got so many inputs, and they've got quant traders that, you know, wrap themselves around this on a, you know, a daily basis. The opportunities are immense, and that's why they're all over it. So I think that there's more than a couple. I think there's, you know, many, many hedge funds that participate in that energy sector.
Just before we finish up, and I know we've taken up so much of your time already, Pete, but those comments overnight from Fed official Lal Brainard there, they were interesting. The US dollar fell against a basket of currencies off the back of those comments. Obviously, a weaker dollar is supportive for commodity markets. How are we seeing the dollar move sort of playing into commodity markets?
Well, she's a dove, and we've got to be conscious of her, I suppose. I've watched her over the years, and she is a dovish, you know, commentator. She's a Fed, you know, from the Fed. Her views are probably, you know, a little bit left of centre. But there's a large contingent of listeners, and we're not, I suppose, in a lot of ways surprised by her comments, Leanne, being the traditional, you know, dove to the market. So in turn, you're going to see, I think, possibly a little bit weaker as far as that US dollar. It'll push it out. If we do see a rate rise, are they going to do it in December? I think there's enough conjecture at the moment as far as the Clinton/Trump engine moving forward to the 8th of November. So there's going to be enough in the market to keep it moving. And I just don't think they're going to have a change. And I think that you could see a little bit of a softness as far as US dollar over the next couple of months, which in turn is going to impact commodities.
All right, fantastic. Peter Maguire, we'll leave it there, but really appreciate you joining us this afternoon. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Leanne.